So the reason I have these two separate from the other properties, I mean, they're on the same two pages, but I put them on the left side because these two are a little bit different. The additive inverse and the multiplicative inverse, we're always looking for a specific answer with these. So when I think about the additive inverse, the goal is to equal zero. We're trying to use a number that is the opposite of another number and put them together so we get zero. In our example in the book, they were using the variable a. I like to use the variable n when we talk about this because the n stands for number. I mean, they all stand for number, but in my head, it just starts with the same letter. So if I have an n, any number, and I want to add something to it to equal zero, the thing to add to it is its opposite. So if I have 15, I would add a negative 15 because we always want this to equal zero when we're working with additive inverse. When do we do this? We do this a lot when we're solving equations. When we're trying to get a variable by itself and there's numbers with it, we want to zero those numbers out if they're added or subtracted. This also works if the first number is a negative. If I have negative 3, I would add to it its opposite, which is positive 3. I would not normally write it like that. I would normally just do this. They mean the same thing. I'm just showing the invisible plus with the first one.
Invisible what?
Invisible plus sign. I don't really need two pluses. I'm just showing we would do the same action. There's an invisible plus over here also, isn't there? Okay. Multiplicative inverse, that's when we have a goal. Our goal is to equal 1. And just as a note, that 1 is usually invisible. I'll show you guys an example of what I mean about it being invisible in a minute. But first, let's do an algebraic version. Again, we're going to use the variable n to stand for any number. So if I have a number n, I would multiply by that n its reciprocal. Yes. What is reciprocal? I'm going to show you that with this example, and hopefully that will answer it. If not, ask me again. Clear? Yes? Okay. So if I have 7, remember 7 is really 7 over an invisible what?
1.
Isn't it funny that we're doing this on the back of our invisible numbers page? My goal is to multiply this by something that's going to give me 1. If I multiply 7 over 1 times its reciprocal, which would be 1 over 7, a reciprocal is it, it's flipped basically. Right? What is 7 times 1?
7.
Over 1 times 7.
7.
7 over 7 is equal to 1. Did that answer the question? Okay. So I made the 1 down here invisible, but we usually don't when we're working with these. We would normally see something like 12 times 1 over 12 is equal to 1. Because in this case, 12 over 12 is our 1. How does that work in algebra? This is where we leave them invisible. If I have something that says like 3x, and I want to multiply it by its reciprocal to get the x by itself, I would multiply that times 1 over 3. And I would end up with 3 over 1 times 1 over 3, and then that x is just still there, this 3 over 1 and this 1 over 3, or 1 times 3, gets me 3 over 3, which is 1. And we would show this as just x. We would have the 1 there, but it's invisible. So that's what I meant by this up here. We're not going to do a ton of this right now in 7th grade math, but it's included in the properties because it's a direction we're moving towards when we start working with equations. Okay?